there within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low, fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all I sip and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. All my life was wrecked by sin and strife, discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus swept across a broken strings, stirred the stumbling chords again. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Feasting on the riches of His grace, resting neath the sheltering wing, always looking on His smiling face, that is why I shout and sing. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Though sometimes He leads through waters deep, trials fall across the way. Hey, though sometimes the path seems rough and steep, see His footprints all the way. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my soon He's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown, I shall reign with Him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my
back again.
Brimstone upon their heads, millstones around their necks, they'll feel the shaking when the trumpet sounds. And no matter where they hide, there'll be nowhere to run when Jesus puts His mighty foot on the ground. Like a dark train running, oh, get ready, because the King is coming, the King is coming back again. Thank you. coming back again.
The king is coming back again.
So wrote the prophet John before his days were done. The king is coming, and it won't be long. Strong, try to make them all think I'm strong. Yeah, the things I keep putting on says I ain't tired. But these tears and eyes ain't lying. Cause hard, nobody told me life could be so hard. A weary soul with a worn out heart that's barely beating. And every time I get that feeling, Jesus, you know I can't do this on my own. I can't do this on my own. Lord knows I've tried, but I'm good at falling down. Thank God you're good at picking me up off the ground. The world's gonna try to break me, but I know the one who makes me strong. Will you make me
Lord, there's nothing I can do. tempter tries to bring me down. When I go to you in prayer, I know you'll meet me there. I can make it through the day when I take the time to pray and I start my day. Sometimes we get so busy that we forget you, and then we wonder why our prayers don't seem to get through. Oh, but in the good times or the bad, Lord, you're the best friend that I've ever had. And when I take the time to pray, you and I can conquer whatever comes my way. When I start my day with you, Lord, there's nothing I can do. Although sometimes the tempter tries to bring me down, when I go to you in prayer, I know you'll meet me there. I can make it through the day when I take the time to pray and I start.
God amazes me. This one, Jeff's going to play for me, but it's an old one. You can sing with me. But God amazes me. I pray for certain things, and sometimes you think they're never going to happen. And because the circumstances causes that problem to keep going and going, and it's most of your family that you see struggles every day. And yesterday morning, I went to a little soccer game for our granddaughter, and things hadn't been going too good for the family. My son wasn't close with his daughter, which is my granddaughter, but this was my great-granddaughter that was playing. And they hadn't been speaking to each other for quite a while. He was there watching the game, and I thought, well, what's going to go on? You know, you're on an open field, you never know. And I didn't know this, but I had the great-granddaughter for the rest of the day. We was going to take her and have fun. And of course, my son's very close with her, and he come over and hugged her. But when I got in the truck, Ed told me that my granddaughter had actually come up to her dad and said, "Dad, I'm going to work." She works for hospice. Said, "I love you." I never even knew that they had even spoke. Last week, they wasn't speaking. So that was a prayer that's answered, that you're just amazed. Now, you're amazed because prayers are answered when you don't think they're going to happen. That's when it happens, and then you go, my lands, that just all day I thought, Lord, you're there when I don't even know it. You're there when I'm not even asking, when I'm not asking that minute, but I've been asking, that's when you answer. So a lot of it depends on prayer. I pray a lot, maybe not down on my knees all the time, but I'm constantly praying in my mind. Pray for my boys, pray for the church, pray for people that's sick. And it you need to pray. That's the main, I think that's the only way to heaven, really. So just listen to the words. It's an old song.
How long has it been since you talked with the Lord and told him your heart's hidden secrets? How long since you prayed? How since you stay on your knees till the light shone through. How long has it been since your mind felt at ease? How long since your heart knew no burden? Can you call him your friend? How long has it been since you knew that he cared for you? How long has it been since you knelt by your bed and prayed to the Lord up in heaven? How long since you knew that he'd answer you and would keep you the long night through? How long has it been since you woke with the dawn and felt that the days were the living? Can you call him your friend? How long has it been since you knew that he cared for you?
Words of encouragement and everything we've heard tonight, but we're going to take in some members tonight, and I know we normally do this the same way, but I'm doing something a little different tonight, if that's okay. So I'm going to give you a little scripture and things here first before we do that. And how many of you tonight, when I write my little pastor's thing in our focus each time, I always put to the Beach Fork Church family. And that's what I feel like we are tonight, is a family. And I'm going to give you a scripture that tells us that we are one. We're one body. We're the body of Christ tonight. Do you want to turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 12? 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and I'll start reading in verse 12. I think this is a wonderful scripture that kind of explains. Paul compares the body of Christ to our human body. And so that's what we're going to talk about a little bit here tonight. Starting with verse 12, says, "For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body also, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, or whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit. For the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, 'Because I'm not the hand, I'm not of the body,' is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear shall say, 'Because I'm not the eye, I'm not of the body,' is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole were hearing, where would the smelling? But now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body as it has pleased him." I want to just make some comparison here. Paul is talking about the human body. In the past few years, we have lost some very, very important members out of this church. I mean, I grew up here with a lot of them, you know, and then, of course, some of them came later, like Jim Allen was on. He was one of our board members, and Jim had a heart attack on us. Johnny Wesley, James Ray, my mom, my dad, Mildred Isaac, some of the different ones. that spent their life here in this church that I grew up with. And they were members here, part of this body of believers, faithful members, prayer warriors, people that I could count on them to pray for me. And there's no doubt in my mind, I'm here tonight before you because of the prayers that my mom and dad prayed for me. Or I would have never made it. I'd have never been here. But it's because of their prayers that I'm here tonight. And I know that they were faithful members. They were encouragers. Big John used to be one of the, he would encourage me no matter how bad I felt like I done. You know, he would always come and put his arm around me and tell me what a great job I done, and you know, and would encourage me. And I know that these guys is kind of hard to replace. But in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, they left this world and they were in the presence of God. I don't doubt that. Where they're at tonight, they're with God. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And I believe that. So, but I want you to understand something. These were important members. These were important people. But none of you here tonight, under the sound of my voice, are any less honorable than the people I just named. God died for you just the same as he died for them. He made a way for you just the same as he did a way for them. And none of you are less honorable. I want to explain this to you. Let me put it. Now, I'm a hillbilly, pretty simple guy. So let me put it to you in something I can understand. A few years back, my big toe on my left foot started hurting, Mark. That thing would swell up and it would get red and I didn't know what was going on with it. So finally it got so bad that I went to the doctor and they checked it all out and he said, well, you got a cyst growing on the bone. So he was the doctor who done my shoulder surgery. I learned a lesson. Shoulder doctors aren't necessarily toe doctors. So he said, well, I can take that off. So he went in there and cut that cyst off, and it wasn't but just a few months that it was back again and hurting again and swelled up again. So I thought, well, this time I'm going to a foot doctor. So I called a foot doctor, and I went to him. He said, yeah, you got a cyst on the bone. That's the same thing the first guy said. He said, no problem, I can take it off. So he took it off, and it lasted a little bit longer. It probably lasted 6 months or 9 months maybe, and it came back again. So I go to a different foot doctor, and he said, here, Mr. Brown, he said, I'm going to take that thing off, and he said, it's going to be one and done. I said, well, that's what I want to hear, because I'm tired of having my toe cut on. So he laid it all the way open, I mean from one end to the other of my big toe, went across the knuckle of it and up, and he took that cyst off the bone, and he said, I was like General Sherman. That's what he told me. He said, I cut and burn everything in there. He said, it won't come back. Well, it did last longer. It lasted over a year that time probably. So now I just live with it. But the whole point I was telling you about this story, the Bible talks in this same scripture in verse 25. It says this. It says that there be no schism in the body. But in verse 4, he said, there's not a comely part of the body. Now, you may feel like tonight that you're not a comely part of the body of Christ. My big toe didn't seem too important, and it sure ain't very pretty. But I'll tell you this. Whenever it started hurting, I hurt all over. I had a hard time getting around and walking and doing all the things that I normally do when a little thing like your toe happens to you. So it is important. It's an important part of my body. And if you have any little part that's out of whack, you know it, don't you? But it's like this. There's not any one of us that's more important than the other. The body of Christ, we need every one of you working in your place with the talent that God has given you. And, you know, I thought these little girls up here singing tonight, what a blessing it is to have them singing. And they're not a better place they could be and use their talent for the Lord. Not a better thing that they could be doing tonight. So none of you are less honorable, just like my big toe wasn't less honorable when it started hurting. I knew that I had to have some help there. So listen to me. We need every one of you honoring one another. And there says in verse 25 that there be no schism in the body. You know what that means? No division. Yes. And there's no place in the church of God tonight, there's no place in Beach Fork Church for us to have division or to have schisms or whatever you want to call them. But we ought to all be working together and encouraging one another, because we're trying to make it to the same place tonight, to the kingdom of heaven. We need to work together. Thank God. So let's encourage one another. You know, encouragement's kind of a lost art, kind of a lost gift. I mean, I mentioned some of the ones that went on. Brother Everett used to come up after we'd try to preach, Doug, and he'd say, "That was the best message I ever heard." Now, he told everybody that after they preached, I think. But it was an encouragement to me. I'd rather have somebody tell me that, wouldn't you, than to come up and say, "I don't know what you preached that for." And I've had some of them try to tell me what all I done wrong or said wrong, you know. Well, when you got the floor, you can preach your message, right? But right now, I got the floor. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank the Lord. So I heard a story of a man, and he'd just gotten married. He'd been a bachelor for years and lived by himself. You know how us men are. So he got married, and this little wife, the first thing he noticed, he come up and opened his sock drawer, and here was all these socks put into pairs together, all the collars sorted out in the collars all together. And that man, he was just so happy for that, you know, and he put his socks on, and he was happy as a lark. Well, it went on for a little while, and the socks ran out. Well, he come kind of talked a little rough to his new wife, said, "What happened to the socks? You know, I like that. I wanted them socks put back in the drawer like that." Well, it went on for a long time, and he didn't have no socks. He wasn't too happy, so he got on her again about getting him some socks and getting them in the drawer and what have you. And still no socks. So it went on for about a month. One morning he opened the drawer, and there was all these socks back in the drawer, all back in order, back in the collar. And he was just happy as he could be, and went downstairs, gave his wife a kiss, and thanked her for putting the socks in the drawer. And guess what? He's had socks ever since. You get the point? A little encouragement goes a lot further than what it does when you try to goad somebody along. And that's what we need, is some encouragers tonight. You know, I tell you, encouragement always works better. We got members that, got a lot of members here. We got a lot of people, and we're going to take in some more new members tonight. But I want you to know this. Encouragement goes a long ways, and everybody needs it, don't they? At some time, every one of us needs some encouragement. My wife does a lot of things, and sometimes I take her for granted. I do. Somebody mentioned that I look nicer tonight. I said, "Well, I just put on what my wife had ironed and laid out for me." I do that every night. Whenever we come to church, whatever she has laid out for me, I put it on and wear it. That's worked for 42 years. I'm not going to try to mess that up. She cooks, she cleans, and does all this. She goes to work and teaches and all the things that she does. She washes clothes, does all that, and irons my clothes and decorates my house, and she does pretty good at all of it. And I know that there's some of you here that does a lot of different jobs. I thought of different ones, and I hate to go naming out. They're Ed and Shirley, I don't think, is here tonight, but they help with the food pantry, do that. There's different ones. You know, of course, we got our door greeters. We got people who does all these jobs. We got musicians who sit over here and play, and you just take all that for granted. You know what? Every once in a while, some of them could use some encouragement too. Especially if you hit a sour note or two. I've been a lot of times I could have used some encouragement. But, you know, people who are faithful to these jobs. And I miss my bass player. I know I try to fill in when he's not here, but I'm not a bass player. But I miss him when he's not here. But him and Mary, you think of all the jobs that they've taken care of in the church, that had led the choir and had plays and all the things they do. And you know, you got Fred and Lola May still living, still with us, you know. And they, we just, some of them here never miss. I can count on you being here. Do you know what that's worth, Pastor? Somebody was talking about taking somebody out, or Michael's going to take us all on vacation when he gets well, the ones that's been praying for him. And I'm looking forward to that. That'll be a good time. And we're going to go. And I'm thinking sometimes maybe the pastor, maybe I ought to take you all out for a dinner or something to show up here and are faithful to be here every service. Yeah. We'll have to save up for that, Ma. We'll get that done. You know, I think of the jobs here in the church, and we got somebody to lead the singing. We got somebody that takes care of all of the paperwork at this place has to have done. And Rhonda, she keeps us all jogged up because my memory is really good, but it's really short. You can tell me something in about 5 minutes. I won't remember what you told me, but her and my wife try to keep me straight. But we need to encourage one another. I thought of this. What about the young ones? You know, the Roops brought little Ruby tonight. I'm starting to worry if they're ever going to bring her for us to see or not, but they did. They come and brought her tonight. We thank the Lord that they're here. But you know, these little babies, when they get big enough, it won't be long until she'll be crawling. And it won't be long until she'll be walking. And I thought, when we try to teach these little ones to walk, what do we do when they get up and, you know, they're stumbling around, staggering around, they fall over? We don't grab them and kick them. What's wrong with you? Why'd you fall down? No, we encourage them. Get them back up. And we try to help them to walk again. And finally, after enough tries, you know, they get to where they'll go on their own. It's the same way with the young ones who get saved in this church. Don't expect them to walk like somebody been on the way for 40 years. They may need a little encouragement. They may fall a few times. And they may need some help getting back up. We don't shove them or kick them down or whenever they fall. We help them back up. I know this is really simple tonight, but I think everybody understands everything I'm telling you tonight, don't you? What I'm talking about. We're talking about being one. We're the body of Christ. We're a family here tonight. And I know we need some good people, some good men and good women of God to step up and to be the encouragers. You know, I was talking about teaching these babies to walk, and you try to teach kids to talk, you know, and the first word I tried to teach my girls was dad. Dada. That's the first thing both my girls, I think, said, was dada. And you know what? I'd go on, dada, dada. And finally, they'd get it after a while. I told them it took us about a year to teach Amy to talk, and I've spent the last 30-some years telling her to shut up. So now Denny's got that job. But and poor little Trey, if that ain't Amy the second, they got their hands full because there ain't nothing he can't say already. So, but we need some good men and women of God that'll step up and to be the encouragers. I thought Big John, when I'd shake his hand was big enough to wrap around mine about twice. And he'd wrap that big hand around mine, and he'd pull me up and hug me and encourage me. I need some people to be encouragers tonight. My mom would always be, I don't care how pitiful or what I done, she was always on my side. She was my encourager, and she lifted me up to the Lord in prayer, and she would lift me up. Brother Deb, he came up one time when I was laying on a hospital bed with my leg broke in a cast, you know, from here and just my toes sticking out down there. And Deb came up, and he said, the Lord will pull you through. If you can stand to pull, that was what he told me. And you know what he did? He brought me through. And it was a lot of my family right here, my own family and some of my church family, that helped bring me through that time that I was in. Me and my wife had just bought a house, just went in debt for a home. And here I was, laid up and couldn't work. I thought for sure I was going to lose the house I just bought. But because of my family and because of church people that helped me along the way, now listen to me,
I would way rather be on the other end of that thing where I could help somebody else than I would to be the one that has to be helped. But you know what? It'll take the starch out of you. When you're the one laying on your back, when you're the one in need of prayer, it'll take some of the starch out of you. It'll humble you down a little bit. Now, I'm not really, I can't say I was thankful that I went through that, but I am thankful for the experience that I had and the help that I got from those times. Old Brother James Ray Brown would encourage every one of us to read the Word. How many chapters you read this week? He made it a point. He read 30 chapters every week, Doug. That was a point that he made in his life to do. And he encouraged every one of us to try to follow that and to read the Word of God. And I'll tell you, you'll never go wrong when you're reading the Word. We need some solid replacements for some of these people that I've mentioned tonight that's went on. Need some solid replacements. We got some coming up, I believe that. I've seen some people lately in this church stepping up and helping to fill some of the voids. Some of these old prayer warriors that we've had down through the years, we need some to raise up. And all these young parents bringing these babies to church. Man, that's the greatest thing that you can do for your children, is to bring them to the house of God. Teach them the ways of the Lord. I look back, I thought of Jeff was talking about the little girls singing tonight, the smart girls. And I said, well, I known their families really on both sides. I said, their papa went to school with me out to Adams County, to the vocational school. And I said, of course, on Heather's side, I've known them way back, all the way back to Daisy. And I knew them a long time back. And I knew the upbringing they had. And these kids have got a chance because they're bringing them to the house of God. And they've got a chance today to make it. Thank God. Keep bringing them, parents. Don't ever get discouraged with it. And I'm going to tell you, it wasn't always real sweet in the Brown household on Sunday morning when you try to get kids out of bed and get them ready for church. And, you know, and when they're babies and you have them all dressed and ready and then they make a mess and you have to redress them and clean them all up, start all over again. All those things that goes on, I understand that you go through a lot to get them here, but it's worth it tonight, church. It is worth it tonight. I'm going to tell you something. You teach your kids about Jesus, teach them how to treat people. I told my girls, I said, I'm going to tell you something. There's nothing wrong with education. Get all the education you can. You know, it'll help you get a job maybe down the road. But I said, I'm going to tell you this. You learn how to treat people, and that'll get you further in life than anything else that you're going to learn, is if you learn how to treat people. Because I'm here to tell you, there's going to be some time you're going to need somebody else in your life. Now, some people says what goes around comes around and all those kind of things. But I'm going to tell you what the Bible talks about. When you bless somebody, you'll be blessed with the same measure. The Bible even says, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. You know, and I think that it's important for us tonight to understand some of these principles that's taught in the Word of God. Get yourself out here and learn to treat people right. And if you do, it'll come back to you. Now, it may not always like you think it will. There's some people, when you're good to them, they're going to take advantage of you. You know how I know that? But I'm going to tell you something. God will always make up the difference. I can't control what everybody else does. I can't control how they accept what I do or whatever. But I can only control what I do. And I'm going to do that tonight. I want you to, just for a moment, would you bow your head? We're going to do things a little different tonight. We're going to take in some new members here. But we're part of the body of Christ. We're part of family tonight. If you're here tonight in this service and you don't know the Lord as your Savior, that's the greatest choice you could ever make tonight. The greatest choice you could make tonight is to accept Him as your Savior. And I don't care who you are. You may think I'm not a comely part of the body, like the scripture I read. You can be part of the body of Christ. He's got a place for you to fit in perfectly. He's got a place for you to fit in. You say you don't know what I've done or where I've been or what kind of life I live. Don't make any difference tonight. The blood of Jesus Christ will atone for your sin tonight. I don't care who you are. He is able to save you from the uttermost to the uttermost tonight. Thank God. Is there anyone here who wanted to step out right now while we're waiting with our heads bowed and say, I want to come and meet the Lord tonight. I want to come and accept Him as my Savior. You can do that. Anyone at all. I'll guarantee you, you make a move toward this altar, there'll be somebody meet you here and pray with you. Anyone at all? Anyone by upraised hand say right now, I didn't want to step out, but I'd like to have the church's prayers. I'd like for you to pray for me tonight. Would you raise your hand all over the building? Anyone at all tonight? This won't save you, but it's a move in the right direction. Anyone have a need at all tonight? Want to raise your hand? They pray for me. Amen. I appreciate you all's attention tonight. I know this has been different, but it's how I felt led to do it. I've got some people here tonight that have turned in membership packets. You've read the bylaws. You've read what we believe as a church, and you agreed to it, that you agree with our doctrine. And some of them I really liked some of the things that you said. So I had one said that they were saved years ago, and they fell away. Now, there's some people preaches doctrines that don't happen, but I'm telling you, it does happen. Now, I agree, you're only going to get saved one time. But you know what they said? They said, I fell away, but I rededicated my life to the Lord. And that's exactly what you got to do. You got to come back. Wherever you laid down the cross, you got to come back and pick up your cross and follow Him. And I like their answer that they gave on that. Now, I won't give away your name or anything tonight, but I appreciated the ones that done this, and it's an honor for me as pastor. And I'm going to have Brother Doug come up if he would with me tonight. And all you that turned it in, your membership packets, and want to become a member, would you just come out tonight, come right up here in front of the altar? I'd appreciate that tonight if you would. And I'm going to tell you, it is as much of the church tonight accepting you as it is you accepting us. And we appreciate the ones that came here. I thought, really, Tanner, he's in college and couldn't be here tonight, and I hate that. And Jeremy's working, and I hated that they couldn't be here, because Tanner really is the one that started this whole... Yeah, Wyatt, inviting him out. Yeah, that's right. But Tanner started coming, and he got saved. And it wasn't long till Mama and Papa, Mom and Dad, and the whole crew came and gave their heart to the Lord, and we're just so thankful for that. And I thought of Ed, he's one of the first ones up on his feet to lead this. Now, they went to church at a different place before they came here, but I don't think that they ever, and I'm not knocking any church, don't get me wrong, but I don't think that they had experienced the Spirit of God like they experienced the Spirit of God here, and that's what made a difference. And he's one of the first ones on his feet when we're worshiping and to help stand up and worship the Lord. He's one of our cheerleaders. And I told Debbie, I wish last Sunday morning she kind of apologized for shouting. And it tickled me to death, because when she let out a war whoop, Jeff Puckett jumped about that high off a piano stool over there. I told him, I said, I wish I could do that, because I'd do it every service. But she one of our shouters. And you know, some people say, well, I don't see any sense in that. Well, I don't see what's wrong with it. I enjoy it. I love it. And it's been part of our worship for years. And of course, I mentioned Heath and Heather coming and bringing these girls, and I know that they're willing to help do anything and volunteer to do anything, and I appreciate that. Oh, yeah, he brings the donuts, big Amish donuts, to the men's prayer meeting, so we appreciate he doing that. And I thought Katie, she's been faithful to come, and she's one of our greeters now, been helping, but she's been faithful to help at the food pantry and just to help do anything she can, and we appreciate that. And old Terry here, he was one of the first ones out of this bunch, I think, to turn in his membership packet, and I've kind of held him off till we got a few, but I don't know, I hope he didn't get weary and waiting on me. But he's been faithful to be here in service, and God's going to use him to win some of his family, and I believe that. You just keep hanging on. And, of course, Cassie, I know that it's just interesting to me that after all the years working at one place, she's changed jobs. But you know, she's changed a lot of things, and God has changed her life, and we just appreciate her faithfulness and coming, and the encouragers, great encouragers to us, and we appreciate them. So here's the thing, new members, I want you at this point to turn around, and the church is going to have a part in this too. I know it's with great pleasure we welcome you to Beach Fork Church, and your presence is a blessing, and you know, we look forward to praying and worshiping with you and celebrating things together with you as a community of Christ. I know you're going to have many things to go through in this life, good and bad, and we want to be there to go through it with you. And they've read and filled out the membership packets, I told you that, and acknowledge that they're in agreement with our doctrine, and they agree and support this church with their attendance and with their tithing. And now I need your commitment to them as a church, okay? And I'm going to ask you a question, and the answer I want from you is, by the grace of God, we will. All right, church, let's all stand to our feet. Do you members of this church enter into a covenant with these fine folks that's standing up here before you for membership and promise to watch over and to counsel and to cherish them, him, and her, and them with all long-suffering, with all gentleness and love? And your answer is, by the grace of God, we will. Thank you. You all are now members of the Beach Fork Church. Me and Doug want to come and shake your hand first. Welcome you in. We love you guys. Just appreciate you.